Good morning and welcome to Taylor United Methodist Church and Unity United Methodist Church. We're excited that you're here to worship with us this morning, and we pray that God blesses all of us in this worship service today. We're pleased to know that we will be able to come back together soon. Unity has tentatively set its date for reopening as June 7. The Taylor Church has not yet set its date, but we'll be announcing it soon. With that in mind, let us go to the Lord in prayer. Almighty God, we come together in spirit once again to worship you, to honor, praise, and adore you. We ask that you bless our worship, accept our praise, and grant our petitions this morning. We pray for our federal, state, and local authorities, Lord. Give them your wisdom, the fruit of your spirit, so they will work together for the benefit of those they were elected to serve. We pray for all healthcare workers and ask for their protection and the protection of their families. For our nation, dear God, we pray for your protection and guidance. We ask that the jobs for the 14.7 million Americans who are currently unemployed be restored quickly. There are people who have never before been on assistance, filling lines now at food pantries. We boldly come before you, God, asking for their economic restoration. For our brothers and sisters needing your healing, we pray for your protection and guidance of their medical teams. All honor and glory are yours, Father Almighty. As we bring these prayers to you, we pray the prayer Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
So, would the young disciples come gather around now? The scripture for this morning's sermon is 1 Peter 2, 4 through 10. And so, with you boys and girls, I want to talk about 1 Peter 2, 4 and 5, because if you understand these first two verses, it will help you understand the sermon a little bit better if you hang around for it. And let's face it, if the grown-ups listen to this with you, then maybe they'll understand the sermon a little better too. So anyway, so 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 4 and 5 say, "You are coming to Christ, who is the living cornerstone of God's temple. He was rejected by people, but he was chosen by God for great honor. And you are living stones that God is building into his spiritual temple. What's more, you are his holy priests. Through the mediation of Jesus Christ, you offer spiritual sacrifices that please God." So how many of you like to play Jenga? Well, this isn't the real Jenga pieces, but it's one of those cheap knockoffs, but it's played the same way. To save some time, I've already built a small tower, and the scripture that I just read to you said, you are living stones that God is building into his spiritual temple. So we could think about this as a spiritual temple. And God is building you into a spiritual temple and with his holy stones. So I want you, though, to look at this bottom block. Let's see if you can see that. Can you see what that says? Yes, it says Jesus. This tower, our spiritual lives, are built upon a relationship with Jesus. Jesus is the cornerstone, or the main stone that holds everything up. And as long as we love him and try to be like him, our spiritual life remains strong and straight like this tower. So, you know that when we play Jenga, we're supposed to pull blocks out. And make our tower bigger. So we can take some things and get rid of them, and our tower or our salvation still stands. We're still part of the body of Christ. So let's get rid of some things and Let's see. I think I might be able to get rid of talking back to mom and dad. Do you think you could get rid of that and make your spiritual life that's based on Jesus stronger? I think so too. What if maybe you gave up fighting with your brothers or your sisters? Could you give up fighting with brothers and sisters? Or maybe what if you were asked to give up your bicycle? If you were asked to give up your bicycle because it caused you to do things you shouldn't do, do you think you might be able to get rid of your bicycle and have your spiritual tower still stand? Yeah. Well, that's a pretty tough one, isn't it? Your tower, though, is still standing, isn't it? Well, do you remember that bottom block I showed you? Remember, and whose name was on it? Jesus. What happens to your spiritual tower if we take Jesus out of it? Jesus is our cornerstone. And without him, our spiritual lives are a mess. So I want you to think about that, boys and girls, and When things just don't seem to like they're going quite right, turn to Jesus and pray to Jesus, and he will help you straighten out things so that you can get your spiritual tower straight. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, help us to stay strong in our faith. May Jesus always be our cornerstone and hold us up when we feel weak. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our scripture lesson today is from 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 4 through 10. You are coming to Christ, who is the living cornerstone of God's temple. He was rejected by people, but he was chosen by God for great honor. And you are living stones that God is building into his spiritual temple. What's more, you are his holy priests. Through the mediation of Jesus Christ, you offer spiritual sacrifices that please God. As the scriptures say, I am placing a cornerstone in Jerusalem, chosen for a great honor, and anyone who trusts in him will never be disgraced. Yes, you who trust in him recognize the honor God has given him, but for those who reject him, the stone that the builders rejected has now become the cornerstone. And he is the stone that makes people stumble, the rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they do not obey God's word, and so they meet the fate that was planned for them. But you are not like that, for you are a chosen people. You are royal priests, a holy nation, God's very own possession. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God, for he called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you had no identity as a people, now you are God's people. Once you received no mercy, now you have received God's mercy. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Thank you. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Fill each of us gathered here this morning with your Holy Spirit, and may only your words be lifted up and heard today. It's in Jesus' holy name I pray. Amen. Mothers have been important to the church from the very beginning. Two of the women that Jesus first told to go tell about the resurrection were mothers. And mothers have been instrumental in keeping the church going for generations. I mean, perhaps there is a woman who nurtured you through Sunday school, or a youth director who mothered you and helped you navigate your teen years. Perhaps you were dragged to church by your mother, a grandmother, or maybe an aunt, or a friend's mother. Mothers are and always have been vital to the church. Some of them were biological mothers, and others may have never born children, but they mothered and nurtured children who were not their own. Susanna Wesley was the mother of John and Charles Wesley, along with a whole passel of other Wesley babies. But John founded the Methodist Church, and Charles wrote many of our great hymns. If you tour the Wesleys' home in Epworth, England, you will learn that Susanna often challenged her husband Samuel. Once, when her husband had been gone for an extended period of time, someone was appointed to fill the pulpit for her husband in his absence. And when the pastor quit preaching the scripture, Susanna took her children home and had church there. She would pull out and read one of her father's sermons, or one of that of her husband's, one of Samuel's, and read these to the children to make sure that they heard the word preached every week. Other people began attending. While attendance at that church began dropping off, Susanna had over 200 people coming to her house for Sunday service. When Samuel learned of this, he wrote and told her to stop preaching. Susanna refused and responded, "If after all this you think fit to dissolve this assembly, do not tell me you desire me to do it, for that will not satisfy my conscience. But send your positive command in such a full and express term as may absolve me from all guilt and punishment for neglecting this opportunity for doing good, when you and I shall appear before the great and awful tribunal of our Lord Jesus Christ." Basically, she said, "You might want me to quit, but if that's the case, convince me that I must, so that when we stand before God, I won't be in trouble for stopping." So I think Susanna could put a firm foot down, and many have often said that it was Susanna's influence upon John Wesley that led him to his belief that women could and should be allowed to pastor. Studies have shown that the way we see ourselves often determines the way we act and react in life. And I think that's probably true for Susanna. She was a strong-willed woman, but she saw herself as a child of God first, and she knew where she stood there. There's a story of a young architecture student who had entered her design for a building in a national contest, and she was devastated after the panel of architects had just awarded her honorable mention because she felt like hers was the best plan there. On the last day of the convention, as she sat there looking at her creation and still wondering how it could have only garnered honorable mention, there was an old man who sat there looking at her creation too. The man didn't know who had designed the building, but finally the man said, "This one, I think, is truly the best of the lot." The young student went home excited. Why? Because that old man was Frank Lloyd Wright, probably the greatest architect of the time. Many people have negative views of themselves because of the information that they receive in their lives. Sometimes we just need to hear that we are worthy from a superior source. And that's what I want to talk to you about today. God is the authority on who we are. He is our creator. He is the one we should be listening to about who we are. I'm focusing on verses 9 and 10 from this morning's scripture. And from that, I have found four I am statements. And that's the title of the sermon this morning, Your Four I Am Statements. If you have your Bibles open and look at verse 9, you'll see that it says, "You are a chosen people." Or some translations say a chosen race. This tells us that you are acceptable. You're chosen. Peter uses language that had been used to describe God's special relationship with Israel. Like Israel was, we believers, the church, are also a chosen people or race. Unlike Israel, though, we are not a people or a race in sense of our family, ethnicity, skin color, or our country of origin. We are a spiritual people, a spiritual race of people, in the sense that through Christ, we share a single spiritual father. In that same meaning, we are a holy nation, a specific group of people called out and set apart from all other nations. I'm not talking nations like United States, England, Germany, or France, or anything like that, but we are a spiritual nation, a holy nation, the Christian people. The word holy means that we're set apart. Most of us spend our entire lives trying to earn acceptance in one form or another. Our desire to be accepted influences the clothes we wear, the cars we drive, the houses we buy, and even if we're students still, who we sit with at lunch. Why is that drive to be accepted so powerful? It's the feel of it. We love being chosen and accepted. Remember playing those games when you were younger, where they divided teams and two people were selected for some reason? Maybe they were the best at something, or they were just picked for the day. Who knows? But if you were chosen first, you felt really good. You felt great. On the other hand, it felt really rotten to be one of the last two standing there, or that last one chosen. when you are chosen, accepted, it raises your self-esteem. Even with your disabilities and character flaws, shortcomings, insecurities, and immaturity, God accepts you for who you are. He accepts you as you are. You're never second best to God, and He will always choose you for His team, even if you don't weigh enough to break through the hands when you play Red Rover. But I won't go there. Second, you're valuable. Okay, so first, you're acceptable. Second, you're valuable. Verse 9 tells us you are God's very own possession. How much do you think you're worth? I'm not talking about dollars. To answer the question, we need to decide what determines value. There are two things that I think of that determine value. The first depends on what someone is willing to pay for something. A house, a car, a piece of art, or a baseball card are only worth whatever someone is willing to pay for them. Second, value depends on who has owned an item in the past. Now, David has bought me some nice jewelry, but if it were auctioned, it may or may not bring what he paid for it. Just because I owned it probably wouldn't give it any extra value except to maybe my kids or my grandkids. But auctions of Jacqueline Kennedy's and Princess Diana's personal possessions reveal that value is truly enhanced by previous owners. So based on these two criteria, what's your value? What are you worth? You know, you're worth an awful lot. The scriptures say you have been bought and paid for by Christ, so you belong to Him. Who owns you? Christ. What was paid for you? Christ owns you and paid for you with His life. God exchanged His own Son for you. The cross proves your value. Jesus gave His life for you, and Jesus didn't die for junk. There was a 19th century preacher named Charles Spurgeon, and he once wrote, "The things are precious, often because of their relationship. The most precious thing a mother has is her dear babe. We all love those who are near to us by the ties of nature. Precious, therefore, in the sight of the Lord are His saints, because they are born in His household by regeneration, made to be His sons and daughters. Think not that God our Father has less affection toward His children than we have toward ours. Ah, no. No mother ever yearned over her children, and no father's bosom ever rejoiced over his heart offspring as the heart of God yearns over His erring children, and as His soul rejoices when they come back to Him. Jesus went to the cross for us. Why? Because we are such incredible value and worth to Him. In society's value system, we may be of very little worth in comparison to a diamond, but to Jesus, we are the most treasured. We are the most precious treasure in the world. Third, you are capable. I'm still in verse 9. You are royal priests, or depending upon your translation, a royal priesthood. Christians together are a royal priesthood. In Israel, under the law, only one tribe served as priests. They mediated between God and the rest of Israel. Very few people could actually come into God's presence. But through Christ, our King, all believers are priests and have direct access to God. We don't have to pray through anyone else or confess our sins to anyone else. We can go directly to God. In addition to this privilege, we have a responsibility to minister to the needs of other people. Every Christian is a minister, not necessarily a pastor, but still a minister. God says that we have been gifted for ministry to serve other people. As the last of verse 9 says, you can show others the goodness of God, for he called you out of the darkness into his wonderful light. An old preacher once said, we are saved to serve. If we aren't serving, then what in the world were we saved for? And fourth, you are forgivable. Once you had no identity as a people, now you are God's people. Once you received no mercy, now you have received God's mercy. You are forgiven. God doesn't rub your sins in, he rubs them out. He doesn't replay your sin like we do. He releases it. When we come to Christ, our sins are wiped out. We will not be held accountable for them. They are forgotten, gone, erased, treated as though they never existed. God is in the business of forgiving sin. He takes all our sins and wipes our slates clean. These are your four I Ams, and I hope you take them with you today. I am acceptable. I am valuable. I am capable. And I am forgivable. We are these things because of what God has done for us. Are we going to mess up? Sure. Are we going to have bad days? Sure we are. But God has told us that we are his children if we trust and believe in him. We may rebel and abuse our rights and privileges, but God still tells us that we are his. We are accepted, valued, capable, and forgiven. What more could we ever want? To Jesus Christ, be all honor and glory. Amen. And now would you receive this benediction? May you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be the glory, both now and to the day of eternity. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.